Thanks for coming. Codan is a company that you may or may not have heard of. We have been around for 60 years, would you believe, started by three proud Australians out of a university that had a great idea to supply radios to the Royal Flying Doctor Service, and the rest's history. So our business is really focused on three core areas. We're the things that we've learned over time. I've been in this role now for 8 years. And one of the things we've learned is to try and talk to investors about the business in terms that gives the investor a bit more certainty. We've been accused in the past of being a stock that can really go up. We were up to $3.95 in share price in 2013, and we quickly came down on the back of some adversity with the way our IP was copied. So we've changed our language, and that language really has resulted in the dividend payouts that you see there. So you'll see in the dividend payouts that we actually pay what we call a special dividend for what we're calling outperformance. And I'll explain a little bit more about how that works and how you should look at the business. By every other measure, I think we do very well. So return on equity, our sales and EBITDA ratios are very, very strong. We are a business that invests very heavily in ourselves with respect to new product development, innovation, and R&D. And that allows us to continue to achieve the kind of margins that we're achieving. This slide here attempts to try and explain a bit more about our business in terms of the way that we would like you to look at us. We have what we call a base level business that we are calling in the range of between $180 and $2 million. And at that level, we expect to produce a net profit after tax of between $25 and $30 million. And so that's what we call the level which we don't expect to go below. That's a base level. It's not our aspiration. It's not what we budget. It's not what we are aspiring to achieve. As you can see, the last 2 years, we've gone significantly above that. And it's for that outperformance, which is mainly caused by gold rushes or gold surges in some of our markets, coupled with timings on large projects. So we do have large projects that we supply all over the world into places like Afghanistan. So our radio business supplies the US military with radios for them to police borders. We supply to Afghani indigenous forces. We also have representation in places like Somalia through the United Nations peacekeepers. None of the places that you would probably want to go on holiday. But there are places that require security, and the world today is becoming less and less predictable, less and less stable. There's more security threats today than there's ever been probably in the history of the world in terms of the way that they are dispersed. And so we play a big part, if you like, in trying to help countries protect their borders, to try to stop the illegal trafficking of drugs, to try and stop people entering the country that they would rather not enter the country. So we look at our level of business in two ways. We talk about a range of base level sales, and we ask investors to value the business on that basis. And in return for that certainty, there's an upside potential, which we call outperformance, for which we pay a special dividend. And that's the way that we've reconstituted the narrative, if you like, over the last 6 or 7 years. Because people have always said to me over the last 2 or 3 years, when's the cliff coming? Because we saw a cliff in 2013. And that cliff was caused by a breach in our intellectual property. It was stolen, and people were purporting to be MindLab in the marketplace using our branding. We've since corrected that with military-grade encryption on our software. And so people are nervous, quite rightly, when they see a share price that has the ability to go from $3.95 down to 52 cents in the space of 12 months. We needed to try to get a better understanding about how the fundamentals of our business operating, and to actually put a base level in place so that there's some certainty for investors like yourself. So moving into the businesses, there's three core areas that we operate in, but that's distributed over four business units. Three of the business units, the communications, the MindLab metal detecting business, and the MindTech tracking business, are probably the bigger businesses. And we have our Codan defense electronics business, which I'll speak about later. And that's really to take advantage of the fact that the Australian government have invested very heavily in defence and are investing very heavily in defence over the next 20 years. But more importantly, Christopher Pyne has been a strong advocate that we should have a lot of Australian content inside our military spend. And so we've looked at our business and went, well, there are core capabilities that we can offer in our area, so let's leverage them. So if we move into the radio communications business, that business is about a $70 to $80 million business. We operate in three sort of areas. It's long-range digital or high-frequency radio, and that's where the Royal Flying Doctor in the beginning of this business formed 60 years ago. We're in markets like Africa and Asia. They're the biggest markets for us in that area. And that's due to the fact that the communications for HF is long-range remote communications. You then move into what we're calling tactical radio, and that's a new area for us. So we've taken our commercial product, which was used for the Royal Flying Doctor Service, it's used for police in Australia, it's used for firefighters, it's used for the emergency services, and we've expanded that platform into a military, more ruggedized platform to take advantage of a marketplace that is arguably four or five times larger than the one that we operate in today. So you can see at the bottom of the slide, there's a new military manpack radio coming in within the next 6 months, and that will supplement the HF Sentry, which is our military version of our commercial radio. And we've already seen a lot of traction, a lot of pipeline in terms of the sales activity, particularly out of places with a developing world military. They simply can't afford to buy some of the Tier 1 Harris, Thales, Tadiran, Selex radios that are upwards of 30 to 40,000 US for two reasons. One is the price, and the second reason is you need a degree in physics to be able to operate the thing. They're pretty complicated. So we've gone and put a radio in place that is very, very simple to use, which is what we've done all along in Africa and other places with our commercial radio. Because some of these people have left school at 10 years old. They can't even read. So we've put what we call an indigenous language platform into the radio so that an Afghani on the border guard station can pick the radio up. It's in Dari on the user interface, and they can navigate it because we've designed it to look like the smartphone that's in your pocket. And interestingly, about 85% of people in Africa have a smartphone and can barely afford to eat in some cases, but communications is key, and it's something that we're trying to capitalize on and try to help them help themselves. If you move into the UHF or the VHF-UHF area, that's the more traditional communications that you'd be familiar with. So it's the taxi. So you get in there, he's got a radio in the taxi. It's people that communicate in built-up cities. So it's a Motorola product. So we bought a business in Canada about 5-6 years ago, and that business is now growing, and we've decided to completely invest and reinvigorate, if you like, the legacy product line. That company had very, very good synergies to Kodan. They were a company that's been in business now for 70 years, was owned by third generation family members, and they look just like us, but in Canada. So we saw them as a supplementary product for our communications business, and we've brought them into the stable, and I'm pleased to say that they're doing very well. Metal detecting or gold detecting on the left has been really the surge that's caused this business to enjoy the kind of profits that we've seen over the last few years. So we have new products coming through in each of the three segments, and that's really the core of who we are. So we're an innovate or die business. We're a business that puts about $25 million a year into product development, and that's upwards of about 10 to 14% of our sales. And we've done that reliably for a long period of time. We need to be able to leave a legacy for future people after they decide that I'm getting a bit too long in the tooth. This product here has been really a game changer for us. It's a new technology called multi-frequency. So in other words, everyone in this room can become an expert in metal detecting by simply picking up a detector, and it's configured to scan the whole frequency band simultaneously, which is how metal detecting works. And so we've been able to incorporate that in a machine, patent it, no one else can do this. And that business has really lifted our base level, which is why we recast our base level up 20%. At the end of last year. And so that's still growing. We're taking a lot of market share from competitors. And of course, we're using that technology, which is a multi-frequency, into some of the other platforms that we are now developing going forward. The MindTech business was a business that we bought about 7 years ago. And so it's taken us 7 years to become an overnight success. It's taken a long time. And the board, at times, were having conversations with me that were quite difficult. Should we really be in this business? Are we the right owners for this business? It's mining. What do we know about mining? And look, we're pleased to say that we're the only people in the world that can solve the problem we solve the way we solve it, which is essentially to have GPS underground. So we can tell where assets are in a hard rock underground mine to within 3 or 4 centimeters. Traditional underground mine products use Wi-Fi zones, so we can tell that we're in a room this size somewhere, but we can't tell that you're sitting next to each other. And that's critical if you're looking at autonomous mining, which is a nirvana for mining, but also for safety and productivity. But we've established a partnership with Caterpillar, and Caterpillar, as you know, are one of the biggest mining companies in the world. They tried to do this themselves for a couple of years after visiting us about 3 years ago. They went, it's all too hard. Came back, we've now signed an exclusive agreement with them, and we're going to use them to take our products to market. And I'm pleased to say that that relationship is going very well, and we've got a number of opportunities that we could only have dreamed of accessing through their network. You can see that the MineStar product is Caterpillar's product. We happen to be called MineTech, so it's almost as if it was meant to be, but it's completely by accident. They came to the party, if you like, with Command, Fleet, and Hell. So that's what they had inside their infotainment system, inside some of the big vehicles in underground mines. We brought in the CSIRO partnered technology, which allows us to do this GPS tracking that I mentioned previously. And of course, together we are MineTech inside MineStar, which is almost like the Intel inside for the computer business. Last but not least, we have looked at our capability. We are essentially a radio frequency or an RF design and manufacturer and marketer. And we've turned that capability, if you like, directed at some of the large projects that you would hear about on the news quite regularly. And so we are very, very well entrenched into the pipeline at this stage. It's all quotations because these vehicles haven't started being built in Australia yet, with the Boxer Land 400 vehicle, and also with the antenna system on the C5000. So it really is taking advantage of the fixed cost base that we have in our manufacturing facility, and we are still one of the few companies that still manufacture in Australia. And so we're trying to just help our fixed costs by turning that capability, which is high-end, into being a supplier to some of the tier ones that you see up on the board there. We've really gotten off to a very good start this year. And I think at the annual general meeting, we did say that we had lifted our expectation for the first half from 20 to 22 million in that range in NPAT. And in the back of that, and based on the way that the company has performed since then, we're pretty confident that we're going to have another very good and strong year, which will cause us to again be in the realm of looking at special dividends. And I think the way that we behaved last year was to pay the special dividend in the second half. That's still something that needs to be decided around the board table. But we are pretty pleased with the way things have started and are continuing, and the core of our business looks very strong. So thank you for your patience. I appreciate it, and I'll open up the floor to any questions.